During my primary school, I really struggled with bedwetting.
Where did you go to school?
So, I was born in a village in Othaya, a village called Karema. Now, at that point, Karema, many people in Kenya would know the Catholic missionaries set up, and many areas are known by the Catholic missions. So Karema was a Catholic mission. But my parents were Protestant. So I went to school not in Karema, which was the nearest place. At that point, actually, you went to school based on your religion.
If you're Catholic?
If you're Catholic, you went to the Catholic school. If you're Protestant, you went to the Protestant school.
All right.
And the gap was quite distinct. You know, you remember by the, because I was born in 1970. By that time, I think the memory of the protestation from the Catholic Church by the Protestant was still very
fresh.
And it reflected in communities, in like my community, not in animosity, but in segregation, kind of thing, separation. So the family is new, it is okay. We you know, you're Catholic, I'm Protestant, we are fine. But our kids don't go to the same schools.
So did that create any animosity?
Not at the family level, not at a community level. And we didn't even know why. You know, we just knew for us, we go to the school in...
But you'd play together?
You play together, you...
Socialize
together. The only thing you know, that's for the Catholics and that's for the Protestants. And we would actually pass each other. It's because for me, I'm going to this side and the Catholic, the other guys are going to this side.
But we never questioned. Distance regardless,
yes.
Wow.
You'd actually pass each other. Hey, hi! You'd even play on the way, you know, play. Then they continue and continue. So I went to a school called Gatuge Primary School, which was further from the nearest primary school, which was Karema Primary School. That is the way it was.
And your siblings as well?
Yeah, all of us. It was standard. It is more recent now that the mixing has happened. You know, history is important. And then after I went to, at that point there was the nursery school, that's where you started.
Yeah.
Then at some point, you then move on to the primary school, which was then across the road, and you continue. And then I finished my secondary school in 1983. I was about 13 years.
So your whole primary school and high school was the same place?
Yes.
Okay.
All of it. My whole primary school was Gatuge Primary School.
Gatuge. What's your fondest memory of that time?
Of that school? I think my fondest memory was me running home every day for lunch.
You know, that entire distance?
Yeah. It was about I would say 3.5 or 4 kilometers when I look back. So you would actually walk to school in the morning. So let me give you a bit of a history about that school. So because this is in the early 70s, learning from nursery school to primary school from standard 1, 2, and 3 was all in vernacular.
Okay.
So when you are in nursery school, the only things you learned was number 1 to 10, and you drew it on the ground because there was no chalkboard.
That was your book.
You all cleaned up and you drew it on the soil. And then you learned the vowels. A-E-I-O-U-A-O. Okay?
That's the vernacular
vowels. That's the vernacular vowels. And then you learned a bit of the alphabet. A, B, C, D, all the way to...
In English?
You were taught. They were drawn on the ground, but you learned them in Kikuyu.
Okay.
But of course, the alphabets don't change, but you're taught in Kikuyu. Then when you reach... a time that now I think they think now you can go to primary school because there are no exams in nursery. They just wanted to know you're tall enough. Okay.
So this is despite the end of year what?
There are no exams.
Okay.
You just learned. So the teacher of course kept probing you to know, you know, you're okay. You know the consonants, you know the alphabet, you know, 1 to 10. You can write them on the ground.
All right.
But the most significant thing, which is actually, again, something in global health we take for granted, is that your height was an important part of you moving to
the next grade.
When you think about it, it was about nutrition.
Right.
Yeah.
Stunted growth was...
Exactly. So if you had stunted growth, you took longer in nursery school. And how did you know the height? You needed to put your hand over your head and you've touched your ear. Yeah. And when you touch your ear now, you're like, now you're of age.
You're ready to move to the next.
You're ready to move to the next step. So nutrition. Undernutrition played a bigger role in you staying longer in school. So children who are not properly breastfed would take longer, okay? And this is of essence in global health. Then I moved to the primary school, and the primary school was across the road. And there, when you're in class one, two, and three, you learned entirely in Kikuyu. So you did your maths, your English, your Kikuyu in Kikuyu. So Kikuyu was a subject also. So you did exams in it. And then you'd only learn up to lunchtime. And then you'd go home. Which again speaks about the environment we are creating for the children. That at that point, you allowed playtime. So you would finish up to lunchtime, as long as you are that age, you go home, then you take care of your mother's cows, you play around, you stay. It's only when you go to class four that actually you extend it to 3 p.m. And then at that point, you then added, you now started to learn in English. You started to learn English. Not to learn in English, you started to learn English. As a subject. So there was no learning of English before. So you now start to learn English as a subject in class four. And then you are now more senior. Now, at that point, it means that when you go home at lunchtime, you have to come back to school.
Oh, so you run for lunch and then...
Yes, and that is now my fondest memories.
Yeah.
Because the bell would go on.
Yeah.
And then you run because you have only 1 hour.
Yeah.
So you run all the way home.
Have lunch.
And the lunch would be boiled maize. You take the boiled maize, you eat quickly, and you run back to school. Because there was also this gender issue that... There was actually, the girls, our classmates, would carry lunch to school.
And why not the boys?
It just didn't feel right for some reason. You know, this gender gap we see was, you know, it's been a historical thing.
Carrying lunch was an issue for boys?
Yeah, it was.
Okay.
So as we grew older, then maybe I would eat my sister's lunch. But carrying lunch was not common. It was the girls actually who carried lunch.
It wasn't... There was toxic masculinity at the time.
There was some toxic masculinity, you know. So you ran to, you ran home, you took your boiled maize, you ate that, then you ran back to school. And those were fond memories because it kind of, it was just a good break. You ran
really
home,
nice.
You ran back. Those I remember very clearly. And then I finished my school when I was 13. That was 1983. And
that's
then I
primary
went
school.
To, yeah, yes.
Yeah.
And then I went to secondary school.
And at the time, you were the exam you would do to complete high primary school was KCE,
no,
Kenya?
It was CPE.
CPE.
Certificate of Primary Education.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you do.
Mm.
And, you know, I remember I scored, it used to be scored up to 36 points.
Mm-hmm.
And the 36 was the highest, the sharpest boys and girls got 36. I got 32. And coming from a village school, that was fairly good because there was no competition. You know, there was no way of telling which is there, how is the other school doing. But I remember my cousin, who was my closest friend then, and we used to come from the same neighborhood, and then he would go to the Catholic school and I would go to a primary school, had 36. So he really, he really did extremely well. But my 32 wasn't too bad, you know,
And then now you, so were you, was there a system that would like call you up to a high school?
Yes. So once you got your scores on that 36 range, then based on that, there'll be a selection, just like goes on now.
Right.
And the Ministry of Education would select, and those who scored highest would go to this school. So because of my performance and also my cousin's performance, we were both called to Nyeri High School,
which is
a provincial school.
Okay.
So my secondary school then from 84 to 87 was in Nyeri High School.
Okay.
Which was within the same district.
And now you're turning into an adolescent to a Nyeri High School.
Exactly. I was turning into an adolescent. And now this was actually quite a critical moment. There's a story at that point, which I like to share, that during my primary school, I really struggled with bedwetting. Really struggled with it. And I think at some point it was a mental health issue. Because I would wake up, my bed is wet, and I wouldn't understand why. And at some point, you know, you have then to get your bedding and put it out to dry then in the evening, and it became part of me.
Are you sharing bed this time?
No.
Given your family?
Yes, you would. You would share the bed. I would share the bed with my brother. And of course, I would be, you know, he was very supportive, but at some point, you know, you also feel it was a difficult thing for me.
Yeah.
And when I went to secondary school, you see, this primary school was day. You just run to school, you come back,
you know,
you wet your bed, maybe you even cover it and hope no one notices. Mm. Then you go to secondary school and now you're boarding.
And this issue persists.
The issue persists.
Whoa.
And now you're boarding and you're sleeping on deckers.
Ooh.
So it became a real, exactly.
Oh.
So it became a really big issue. Yeah. Oh. And the mattresses are?
Thin.
This thin.
Oh, man.
Yes. That
and
was actually
high
one
school,
of. Yes.
You're a boy.
You're a boy. It's a boy's school.
How did you handle that?
It was difficult. My mother tried. My mother, you know, of course, you know, just a subsistence farmer. Mm. She knows this.
Mm.
And now I'm in secondary school. So it becomes an issue. And she starts to take me to hospital now. We never saw it as a medical issue before. It was just a social issue at home. So she starts to take me to Nyeri Provincial General Hospital.
Mm.
Of course, you're going to the public hospital. The doctor there tries. And it's not an easy thing to resolve. You don't know what the issue is.
Mm.
Sometimes it's you know, you don't really understand, you know. You know, the doctor proposes many solutions for you, and my mother struggles with them. At some point, he says I should buy an alarm clock. One of those, you know, those ones that have a gong like this. It's like the time, you have to wind them up to the time, because there was no digital things at that point, alarms.
Mm.
You wind it, you say at this point, so it would have a gong, then you wake up to go to the?
To the washroom.
To the washroom. So that it hopes that then, you know, you don't bed wet at night.
Mm.
So we tried all that.
So like you set it up a number of times
before you,
across
yes.
the night.
You set it up at night, then you get up.
Mm.
Of course, the disturbance. You're in school,
yeah.
The other boys are asleep. You're sleeping in an open dormitory.
Yeah.
But somewhere around my form two,
it
just disappeared.
So it was, what was it? Was it a medical issue?
We don't know. I think, and bed wetting is very common, actually. I don't think we pay attention to it. If I was actually to go to schools now, go to families and say, let's record how many kids bed wet at their year 10. There are many.
Mm.
But these are not issues people talk about because they don't have a medical solution. You know,
right.
Some of it could just be upbringing, could be maybe you have some mental health issue you don't know. But those things are just ignored, you know.
Mm.
So I suspect it is actually quite common. It's an issue that I probably would like to pay attention to at some point.
And guys don't talk about it often.
People don't talk about it because it's just a social issue.
From where you come from, and that just now that you brought it up, is it more common in boys? Is it more common in girls?
I think it's more common in boys, but I don't have statistics to share. It is something when I think about it, I need to pay more attention to. Because it must be quite common and distressing. It is very distressing. If you are not strong-willed, it could be a cause of dropping out of school when you think about it, because of the shame and embarrassment associated with it. So it is something that we need to pay more attention to. But at that point, it was a big issue for me. But it tends to actually just disappear. Because it's also about consciousness and in awareness. So as you grow older, it disappears. So mine disappeared maybe when I was in Form 2, and that was it. So I remember that very distinctly. As a high school milestone, exactly.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I finished my high school in 1987.
All right.
That was the secondary school. At that point, we used to go to A-level, the advanced level.
Mm-hmm.
So at secondary school, then you did the Kenya Secondary Schools Examination Certificate. So you do that, and then you go into... I went to Mangu
your A-levels.
For my A-levels. That was for 5 and 6.
Mm-hmm.
That was 88 and 89. Mm.